I guess we can start with at the exact time because we have a full hall. So welcome everybody, good evening everybody, welcome at the Institute. As you know, this event is part of the program which has been organized by Carnegie Hall, and we are partners, we are very pleased, happy partners of Carnegie Hall in participating in this program, which is devoted to the Republic of Venice, Venice as an independent republic, La Serenissima, and it's a program that includes not only music, concerts, musical events, but also talks. And this evening, we're very happy to host a talk that will reconstruct some of the historical aspects of La Serenissima. And when Carnegie Hall asked us if we wanted to be partners, we accepted very gladly, and we were immediately and completely in agreement about the guests that we should invite. And, you know, happily both of them accepted our invitation, so we are honored and pleased to have with us Professor Alessandro Barbero and Professor Edward Muir. I will, before joining me in welcoming them, I will just spend a few minutes not doing them justice, not doing justice to their work, because their work is very, very extensive, but just to sum up a few main points about their career. Alessandro Barbero teaches at the University of Eastern Piedmont in Italy, where he is professor of medieval history, an area in which he has written extensively and in which he has also been translated into English. Even if his scholarship focuses on the Middle Ages, his writings range from the Greek and Roman times to the 20th century. And also, as genre, they range from historical scholarly studies to works of fiction. He's also a novelist, and he was awarded the most important literary prize in Italy, the Premio Strega, in 1996, with a novel, Bella Vita e Guerre Altrui di Mr. Pyle Gentiluomo, which has as a narrator and a protagonist an American diplomat, an American, a special type of an American, an American in Europe, let's say, at the beginning of the 19th century. Among his subsequent novels, I just want to mention Gli Occhi di Venezia, which has been translated into English as The Eyes of Venice, and is set in Venice at the end of the 16th century, so the period that we are going to talk about today, this evening, and latest, Le Ateniesi, Athenian women. Set in Athens at the end of the 5th century BC. Professor Edward Muir holds an endowed chair in the history department at Northwestern University in Chicago. His main area of scholarship is Italian culture and the Italian Renaissance. He focuses particularly on the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, with a special interest in the history of violence and ritual. He has written numerous volumes on the subject, starting with his first work, Civic Ritual in Renaissance Venice. And I would like to mention also Sex and Gender in Historical Perspective, as well as his most recent volume, The Culture Wars of the Late Renaissance, Skeptics, Libertines, and Opera, published by Harvard University Press. He has also been the recipient of all the major fellowships in his fields of study, and I want to mention at least one. Since I'm from Florence, I'm glad that he was the recipient of the ITATTI, the Harvard Center for Renaissance Studies ITATTI scholarship. So he had the opportunity to deepen his knowledge not only of Venice but also of Florence. And he is also the editor of major book series on the Renaissance and of scholarly journals on the field. The last thing that I got to know about them and that they share, and I want to mention it, is that they have both received recognition and awards, not only for their distinguished and outstanding scholarship, but also for their excellence in teaching. And that's, you know, something that is also important to stress in this time when we speak more and more about online teaching, and it's important to highlight the value of academic teaching and university teaching. So please join me in welcoming Alessandro Barbero and Edward Muir.
Ma no, va bene così, direi, va bene così. Grazie mille.
Well, we were wondering whether the micro is close enough to my mouth. Is it? Yeah. Are you hearing me? Okay, thank you. So, we'll talk about Venice and the Ottoman Empire. During the Renaissance, two mighty empires shared control of the Eastern Mediterranean, of the Balkan coastline, the Greek mainland, and islands, down to Crete and Cyprus. One was the great Ottoman Empire, whose dominions stretched from its capital city of Constantinople northwards to the Danube, eastwards to Armenia and Mesopotamia, westwards to Algiers. The other one was Venice, a republic and yet an empire of an altogether different kind, but an empire of the same. Venice was an empire of the seas, of naval bases and island garrisons and fleets, with almost no hinterland, if one accepts the great capital city itself, one of the biggest concentrations of population and wealth in the Christian world. The two empires had little love for one another, first and foremost because no empire has ever had any sympathy for another one. Empires are born to fight, and unlike animals, they eat their own kind. Add that the two empires followed two different religions, which had developed in the last centuries a strong and active prejudice against one another. Venice, of course, was a Christian and Catholic empire, while the Ottomans were Muslim. The historian is bound to introduce many nuances in this black and white picture. Both empires, for instance, had vast numbers of Greek subjects, Orthodox Christians, who disliked Turks and Italians alike. The Sultan, who had more of them, sent to sea war fleets whose rowers were in large part Christian Greeks. And I'm not talking of slaves, but of subjects who had to serve their sovereign just like their Muslim counterparts. Even more shocking, most grand viziers, pashas, ministers, generals, and admirals, as well as the rank and file of the Janissary regiments, were drawn by preference from the Christian subjects of the Sultan. And although officially they all converted to Islam on entering his service, all of them were born baptized Christians all the same. But official propaganda and popular mentality didn't linger on such contradictions. In the eyes of both sides, the Ottoman Empire was an Islamic empire. The Sultan was also the Caliph, Prince of the Believers and Protector of Mecca. And in the language of his own official documents, his fleet was the Muslim fleet and his army, the Army of Islam. So that both sides could happily explain to their subjects that God was on their side and that the enemy were cursed infidels, unbelieving dogs. They resembled each other very much, Christian and Muslim, the same language and the same way of thinking. And yet, the relationship between Venice and the Ottoman Empire was much more complex than that. Let's examine first the image of the Venetians in Turkish eyes, and we'll discover that they managed to entertain both hate and fear and admiration towards them. The visible economic prosperousness of Venice aroused antagonism mixed with reluctant recognition. Let me quote perhaps the greatest Ottoman historian of the 17th century, Katib Celebi. "The infidels of Venice, a brood running to its ruin, are well known for the abundance of riches, a flowering commerce, and a trade network regularly twisted by deception and fraud. One should not trust their demonstration of friendship. They get along thanks to deceit, proffering to be our friends, no doubt with ill wish, and yet more adverse in their hearts than any other infidel, they remain at the bottom enemies of the true faith. Their supreme head, the Doge, poses as a prince, but he's merely a merchant. His rank is far beneath that of a king, and when he dies, the other chiefs of the Venetians play dice for his succession." So far, the Turkish chronicler. No, not so far, still something more. "It's shameful that such people as the Venetians should own so many possessions as to limit the vital space of the empire. The Venetians, a wretched company, drifting and disbanded, who among the infidel monarchs hold the lowly grade of duke," Doge means duke, you know, "known among the unbelievers with the nickname of the fishmongers, have attained the throat of our well-guarded dominion, trying to check a state of most eminent glory, which rules the East and the West." So far, in fact, the Ottoman chronicler. But alongside with this imperial rhetoric, which liked to make fun of the sea-obsessed Venetians, labeling them as fishermen or fishmongers, the Turks could not avoid to recognize the other side's superiority in some fields at last. Great fighters on horseback, the Turks always feared not to be the equals of their Christian counterparts in sea fighting. As Grand Vizier Lutfi Pasha had said to Suleiman the Magnificent, among your forebears, many held sway over the land, but only a few were masters of the seas. The infidels are above us when war is taken to the sea. And yet the sultans, with characteristic stubbornness, kept building fleets and sending them to the waves. And victory and defeat often swayed between the two sides, and with it, public opinion and the level of optimism. When the son of Suleiman, Selim II, went to war against Venice in 1570 for the possession of Cyprus, at first, public opinion in Constantinople was dismayed. Bad omens ran wild among the people of the capital. The fleet was said to have been wiped off by the Venetians. And in the house of Piali Pasha, its commander, the women wept and prayed for his escape. But in fact, that summer, the Venetian fleet, beset by an epidemic of typhus, couldn't stop the Ottoman fleet from landing the invasion army in Cyprus. And when the good news was known in the capital, the mood instantly changed. Venetians are fishermen, and they can't stand making war against us, said Grand Vizier Mehmet Pasha, a Bosnian Serb and an Orthodox deacon in his youth, to his chief interpreter, Dragoman Ibrahim Bey, a Catholic from Poland by birth. When Venice, not altogether happy with that war, sent an envoy to the port to open peace conversations, he discovered to his dismay that the Turks were not afraid anymore to measure against Venice at sea. He wrote home, "They believe that our men have no experience of war, nor any fighting spirit left, so that they think but little of us." So that particular war went on, and the Ottoman fleet was duly crushed at Lepanto on October 7, 1571. A battle of such little military consequence that in its immediate aftermath, Venice renovated peace proposals and agreed to surrender Cyprus to the Sultan because her commercial interests were exceedingly damaged by war. Before the Cyprus War, Venice had enjoyed a 30-year peace with its Muslim neighbor, and an even longer peace would follow with mutual satisfaction. The fact is that life in the Mediterranean depended on trade. And while the Ottoman Empire, unlike Venice, was a land empire whose main economic activity was agriculture, trade was important to its political elite. Venice was the only place where the rich and powerful of Constantinople could buy the marvels that the accursed infidels inexplicably went on producing, and that could be found nowhere within the empire. In Venice, Grand Vizier Mehmet Pasha purchased spectacles, clocks, geographical maps. Sultan Selim's sister, Mirima, ordered in Venice tools and steel for the aqueduct she was building in Mecca at her own expense. Other pashas purchased, or managed to get for free, glass, luxury clothes, musical instruments, like the portative organ Piali Pasha acquired on his wife's orders. She too was a sister of the Sultan, and therefore to be obeyed. From Venice came to Constantinople the much-praised Parmesan cheese, as well as almost all the cloth needed to dress the Sultan's court. The Pashas were so accustomed to satisfying every whim by placing orders in Venice that when the Sultan's fleet was preparing for the invasion of Cyprus, and while war hadn't been officially declared, the Capudan Pasha, the fleet's commander, asked the Venetian ambassador, Marcantonio Barbero, to get him special Venetian glasses for the new great lantern of his admiral's ship. And the ambassador duly complied, even though he suspected that that ship would lead the fleet against Venice. But even aside from the luxury market, trade relationships with Venice were essential to the Pasha's prosperity. For these politicians and soldiers were also businessmen and very crafty ones. As Italy was far in advance to the Eastern world in the development of commercial skills, the Venetians' partnership was needed on many occasions. Piali Pasha, the same admiral who would lead the invasion fleet to the beaches of Cyprus, in peacetime was a big ship owner, and he needed insurance policies for his ships. But in the Ottoman Empire, insurance was unknown. So he addressed the Jewish merchants of Ancona, subjects of the Pope, who had trusted business partners in Constantinople, and they referred him to Venetian businessmen who accepted to insure his ships. Even though when one of them actually sank, the Pasha discovered that getting his due across the frontier was not so easy. But the Venetian ambassador in Constantinople was there exactly to speed things up in such occurrences. It was in the interest of the Republic to cultivate friendly relationships with the ministers of the Sultan. This friendship was nowhere more visible than in the matter of grain trade, a question of life and death to the Venetian government, who had to feed a city of 150,000 on a tiny and poor hinterland. So they customarily purchased grains in the east, and the Pashas, owning considerable land in the Balkans and the Greek islands, were major players on this market. This meant, of course, that the Sultan wielded a powerful instrument of pressure. He could threaten to suspend the grain export whenever Venice displeased him. And that's exactly what happened before the Cyprus War, when the Republic refused the Ottoman request to voluntarily surrender the island to her good friend, the Sultan. But the very same government which enacted the ban on grain trade against Venice was composed of individuals who made enormous profits from the grain trade itself and who had no intention to give it up. Marcantonio Barbero, the Venetian ambassador, easily discovered owners of small ships who accepted to embark grain on the Pasha's properties, ostensibly to sell it in Constantinople, and then secretly ship it to the Venetian islands of Crete or Zante. The Pashas, who had officially banned the grain trade on the Sultan's order, all secretly accepted to sell it underhand. This so-called secret risked to be publicly exposed when one of the shippers came to Constantinople to prosecute one of his partners who hadn't respected the contract. And Ambassador Barbero had to recur to physical menace to keep him quiet and convince him not to file a report to the Grand Vizier. "Nobody here," wrote Barbero to his government, "wants it to be known that the wit of the magnificent Pashas turns up in Christianity against the orders of the most serene Lord, the Sultan." In the aftermath of the war, the grain trade was officially resumed, and the Venetian authorities kept a very attentive eye on its course. In the 1590s, when Italy was hit by perhaps the worst famine since the Middle Ages, only the wet boat in Constantinople by the Venetian ambassador of the time, Senator Girolamo Lippomano, kept people alive in the big city. Lippomano was a shrewd politician and diplomat who had served the Republic in important missions, though none so important as the post in Constantinople, probably the key job in the Venetian administration beneath the Doge himself in the Council of Ten. Well, one day it happened that the Ten received a circumstantial report that Ambassador Lippomano was cheating the Republic in the grain business, declaring higher prices than he actually paid and pocketing the difference. No matter how grand Lippomano's place was in the Venetian elite, this would cost him his head. A new ambassador was secretly dispatched to Constantinople, who would present his credential to the Sultan and politely ask permission to arrest his predecessor and bring him to Venice. An unsuspecting Lippomano was convinced to embark on a Venetian galley, and once on board, he discovered he was under arrest and his secret betrayed. Some weeks later, when the galley approached the embankment at the Lido, Lippomano chose to throw himself into the sea, preferring death by drowning rather than face dishonor and a public beheading on Piazza San Marco. As you see, ambassadors were key to the relationship between Venice and the Ottomans. No wonder then that every one of them, coming back to the fatherland after his assignment among the infidels, was asked to read to the Senate a very long and detailed relation of everything he had seen and learned. These relations are still the most trustworthy and detailed source we have about the Ottoman Empire seen under Western eyes. Marcantonio Barbero, he of the Cyprus War, presented his report too, after an unusually long stint. In fact, he had been due home after some years of service when the war broke out and the Turks wouldn't let him go. They debated whether they should imprison him in a tower, but consulting the precedents, they discovered that during the last war with Venice, some 30 years before, the Venetian ambassador had been let to live unharmed in his palace, and the same policy was applied this time to Barbero, who spent 3 years more in Constantinople. Janissaries at his door prevented anybody to go out or in, with the exception of servants carrying provisions. In fact, looks like Barbero had no difficulty in corrupting his janissary guards and sending out regular reports to his governments in Venice. By the way, the Venetian didn't play fair in response. There was no permanent Ottoman envoy in Venice, but when an ambassador from the Sultan to his good Christian ally, the King of France, happened to pass through Venetian territory, he was promptly arrested and put to prison by the Venetians, provoking an indignant response by the French government, which argued that Venice was violating international law. When Marcantonio Barbero finally left Constantinople, peace having been agreed, he left a gift to Grand Vizier Mehmet Pasha, his own portrait with a Latin inscription, a dedication to the Lord Mehmet, Vizier of the Muslim, my very good friend. Back in Venice, Barbero explained that the Ottoman Empire was a growing force and that it still could become master of the whole world. It was therefore useless for Venice to try to stop them. Far better to cultivate their friendship. And he bitterly chided the Senate for not accepting his advice 3 years before and embarking in that disastrous war. So much for the historical significance of the Battle of Lepanto, still quoted sometimes in the West as the event which marked the end of Ottoman expansion. Barbero explained also something interesting to the senators. He explained that while in Venice, the patrician elite had a total monopoly of political power, so that every appointment went to noblemen and depended on their family and alliances as much as on their own competence, the Turks followed a thoroughly different system. The Sultan would appoint only men of lowly origins, who had been remarked in their youth by ad hoc committees and brought to the capital to be educated under his own supervision. True to the prejudices of his time and country, Barbero affected to find it shameful to be forced to make terms with such men as the pashas and viziers were, low-born and therefore alien to any noble feeling. But he was forced to add that among them, merit only was considered, and no appointments were granted by patronage. When a son of Mehmet Pasha had been made governor of a small faraway province, the choice had been severely criticized by public opinion in Constantinople, as they can't suffer that even the son of a prime minister may get an appointment graced to family connections. Aristocratic disdain for the lowly birth of viziers and pashas whose fathers had been peasants and shepherds, and for a people which, unlike Western societies, ignored the privileges of nobility, appears often in Venetian commands. The admiral of the fleet which won the Battle of Lepanto alongside with the Spanish, Sebastiano Venier, once wrote about the humiliation of fighting an enemy who has no place for counts, nor knights, nor gentlemen, but only for merchants. And yet some of the envoys who came back from Constantinople had learned otherwise. And sometimes it happened that one of them remarked to an unbelieving Senate that the Turkish system, however outlandish, had its advantages, and that it would not be a bad idea to try it in Venice too, choosing some gifting plebeians and appointing them to high responsibilities, just like the Turks did. Of course, they didn't even give it a try. And so Venice saw its grandeur decrease until she was not a great power anymore and slowly sank into political and economic insignificance. But the same happened to the Ottoman Empire and to every power and every people locked in the shrinking backwater, which would become in subsequent centuries the Mediterranean. Thank you.
We will have a Q&A session at the end. So now I welcome Professor Muir, but it will take me. It will take me just a minute.
Thank you so much. It's a great pleasure to be here. We have an Istituto di Cultura Italiana in Chicago, but it's nowhere near as elegant as this, and it's very, very nice. This is an image that in many ways represents the... Can everyone hear me all right? I'm going to have a... No, I'll stand... Okay, I'll be cool here. This is an image that actually is from the late 19th century by a Dutch painter, which in many ways represents the idea of freedom of thought in late Renaissance Italy and Europe. It shows Galileo, our symbol of the free thinker in modern culture, trying to explain to Pope Urban VIII the nature of the Copernican system as he looks up. Urban VIII seems to be taking this lesson seriously. I'm not sure that the real Urban VIII ever really did, but what I'm going to be talking about today is, in some ways, the deeper context of the freedom of thought in Venice, that did involve Galileo, and includes a number of figures who are not as familiar, not as a familiar story as the Galileo story is. Gabriel Naudet, the French free thinker and Cardinal Mazarin's librarian in France, obviously, famously claimed that 17th century Italy, and especially Venice, was, quote, full of libertines, atheists, and people who believe in nothing, end of quote. Now, as one of the forefathers of the French Enlightenment and an advocate of the open public library, Naudet could be considered a reliable source about Venetian intellectual life. He had studied at the University of Padua, where he was charmed by the charismatic Aristotelian philosopher Cesare Cremonini, who seemed to have denied the Christian doctrine of the immortality of the soul, if not exactly in print, then at least in the near universal opinion of his students and his friends and his enemies. Cremonini, and here he is, was said to have composed his own epitaph, Hic Iacet Totus Cremoninus, which we could translate as Here Lies All of Cremonini, a pithy way of saying that his soul had died with his body. And in his reading of Aristotle, divine creation, God's providence, and the whole Christian scheme of salvation could not be proved philosophically. An argument that may or may not have expressed his personal views, that's hard to tell, but conformed to the standard defense of a Renaissance Aristotelians. Oh, we're just philosophers trying to read Aristotle. We are not theologians. Cremonini's response to his Jesuit critics reminds me of the answer I received when I once asked the head of the Croatian Historical Institute for her assessment of the ethnic violence during the breakup of the former Yugoslavia. And she replied, "That is not my department." Same thing for Cremonini. Cremonini survived more than 80 investigations by the Roman Inquisition, which probably made him the most thoroughly examined Counter-Reformation thinker in Italy, if not all of Catholic Europe. He was probably more of a concern to Roman authorities than his good friend and colleague, Galileo Galilei, or even the martyred philosopher Giordano Bruno, who Galileo had bested for the professorship of mathematics at Padua and who was burned at the stake in Rome in 1600. Unlike Bruno, can you hear me? Is my voice going away or is it okay? Okay, good. Unlike Bruno, who alienated his Venetian protectors, Cremonini died a natural death because as a Padua professor, he was under the protection of the Republic of Venice. And unlike Galileo, he, that is Cremonini, never made the mistake of leaving Venice's university at Padua or talking too openly when reticence was the wiser course. As he put it, "That's not my department." Naudet described Cremonini, and here I give a quote, as a great man with a lively mind, which knew no inhibitions. He was free of illusions and stupid prejudices, and he knew the truth perfectly well, although in Italy no one dared spell it out. All the professors in that country of the Republic of Venice, and especially those in Padua, are free thinkers. Cremonini skillfully kept his private opinions to himself, being in Italy. And one of his maxims was, think what you like, but say what is expected of you. end of quote. Now, despite the requirements of public dissimulation during the Counter-Reformation, the city of Venice and its satellite university town of Padua remained a relatively free-thinking island in the Catholic world. Due to the intermingling of ideas from Catholic skeptics, Jewish philosophers, and various heterodox foreigners who constituted what was perhaps the most diverse population in Western Europe, Venice was unusually cosmopolitan. Padua was the only university in Italy where Protestants and Jews could actually study alongside Catholics, despite the Council of Trent's prohibition of giving non-Catholics degrees. Venice had the largest publishing industry in Italy and one of the largest in Europe. Venice and Rome had signed an agreement back in 1596 to enforce the index of prohibited books among Venetian publishers. But if only for commercial reasons, the Republic was a very reluctant censor and prohibited books, dangerous stuff like Machiavelli or Luther or vernacular Bibles in Italian, could usually be bought from under the counters of Venetian booksellers. After all, books in the language of the vernacular languages was something Protestants did, not Catholics. But here, however, is, as you can see from 1551, a book, an Italian Bible, published in Venice, and one of many that managed to circulate despite all of these prohibitions. In its official culture, the Republic of Venice was certainly Catholic, but Venetian officials were jealous of their prerogatives over the local church, which brought them into direct political conflict with the Counter-Reformation papacy. Especially after the epic confrontation between Venice and Rome, when Pope Paul V placed the Republic under interdict in 1606 and 1607, the Republic tolerated and sometimes even encouraged unconventional religious speculation and certainly rabid anti-papal polemics. Now, during the Renaissance, many thought that there were even atheists in their midst. The anti-Trinitarian thinker Lelio Sozzini of Siena in 1549 reported, quote, "Most of my friends are so well-educated that they can scarcely believe God exists," end of quote. And in fact, the word atheist was an invention of the 16th century, and its first use in English in 1568 was in reference to the Italian atheists, such as Giulio Cesare Vanini, here he is. Most of these atheists, however, were probably just skeptics of some sort. But Vanini, who had visited Padua in 1608 when Cremonini, the gentleman I began with, dominated philosophical studies, Vanini preached against the papacy in Venice. He openly proclaimed his atheism and eventually paid the price for his lack of belief with his life when he was convicted in 1619 by the Parlement de Toulouse for atheism and blasphemy. And he suffered the blasphemer's penalty. His tongue was cut out, he was strangled, and his body burned. This obviously is anachronistic. If you look up atheist on Google images, this is what you get. Vanini successfully assembled a philosophical and rhetorical foundations for unbelief. But his fate demonstrated to those who might have agreed with him that they must not be so explicit. Thus, two questions arise from Vanini's example, especially since he was so well known in Venice. How did others express similarly dangerous ideas? And how did those who thought like Vanini manage to survive? Now, the most important figure who might have agreed at least with some of the things that Vanini had been saying was his acquaintance in Venice, the Servite friar Paolo Sarpi. Known throughout Europe for his history of the Council of Trent, which was published under a pseudonym in England, because he couldn't get it done in Italy, in 1619. Sarpi depicted the Counter-Reformation Church as devoted to worldly rather than spiritual concerns, a stance that made him popular in Protestant countries, especially England, but also among Catholics who opposed papal interference in secular matters, including the Gallicans in France and certainly in Venice. He served as the official theologian and legal advisor to the Venetian Republic during the papal interdict against Venice, beginning in 1606. He forcefully and brilliantly defended in print not just the republican liberty of Venice, but the rights of secular princes everywhere against the universalizing claims of the Counter-Reformation papacy. Sarpi's numerous pamphlets defending Venice during the internet crisis led some to compare his attack on the papacy to those of Luther and to imagine that a new Reformation was in the works and its home would not be Wittenberg, but Venice. His attacks on the papacy hit home. Two assassins hired to kill Sarpi stabbed him. Oops, let me see. I think I'm in the wrong spot. Here he is. These two assassins hired to stab Sarpi did so while he was crossing this bridge right here, Ponte Santa Fosca, which was just outside his convent. And the would-be murderers fled to the papal state and later received a pension from the Spanish viceroy in Naples, which revealed the hand of those who had hired them. As you see, this in many ways is the sacred spot for the freedom of thought in Venice, Campo Santa Fosca with its statue of Paolo Sarpi in the middle and a memorial to the attack upon him. Now, Sarpi survived the attack and produced a series of books that lambasted clerical wealth, the papacy, and the Habsburg imperial ambitions in Italy. Sarpi's survival, not just from potential assassins, but from persecution by the Roman Inquisition, depended entirely on his Venetian patrons, who for the next half century refused to allow the papal nuncio or the Roman Inquisition or the Jesuits to interfere in internal affairs of the Republic, and of course that includes the vast mainland as well as the city itself. One of the signs of Venice's continued resistance to the Counter-Reformation, even after the conclusion of the interdict, was the refusal to allow members of the Society of Jesus to return to Venetian territories. As a result, Venice became a haven, not just for Sarpi, but for other writers who held dangerous anti-papal, anti-clerical opinions. Now, what made Sarpi a radical was his willingness to contemplate the creation of a purely secular society, a state composed, in the words of David Wooten, of a state of moral atheists. For Sarpi, religion and politics must be kept entirely separate. In this sense, he sounds awfully modern. And the responsibilities of a citizen or subject need not have anything to do with Christian morality. Once he had thrown off religion as the social underpinning of society, Sarpi could suggest that the state might allow complete freedom of conscience. And along with Montaigne, he became one of the early advocates of religious toleration. Now, in Venice, the most important legacy of Cremonini and Sarpi was the Accademia degli Incogniti, the Academy of the Unknowns. For nearly 30 years, from its founding in 1630 by some of Cremonini's students, an international group of aristocrats and highly educated clerics gathered in Venice under the auspices of the Unknowns, where they found trustworthy men who engaged in conversations about all possible topics. And I must add, it is this group, the Unknowns, who sponsored, built the theaters for, and wrote the librettos for the first commercial operas, beginning in 1637. So we have them to ask and to thank for modern opera. The freedom and the very survival of the Unknowns depended on their founder, Giovanni Francesco Loredan. Let's see if I can. Yeah, there he is. Who lived from 1607 to 1661. Loredan was a member of one of Venice's most prominent patrician families and a successful politician himself who regularly was elected to important state councils from which he could guarantee the security of the other unknowns. Even so, the unknowns did their best to remain unknown by hiding behind pseudonyms, anonymous publications, false places of publication, and elaborate metaphorical language. And I must admit, having worked on them, figuring out what they're trying to say is sometimes a real challenge. In Venice, the absence of the Jesuits for a half century after the 1606 interdict and an anti-papal political culture theorized by Sarpi and by the Academy of the Unknowns made it possible for the formulation of the most prominent community of free thinkers during the late Renaissance. Loredan's financial resources and political clout gave him unprecedented influence in Venetian publishing. The long conflict with Rome after 1606 had taken a toll on the presses, which before then had relied largely for their regular income on the printing of breviaries for priests and vernacular religious tracts for the laity. Now they couldn't get licenses to do that. The publishing depression reached a crisis in 1632, when only five presses remained active in Venice. Taking advantage of the crisis and the group of experienced printers, Loredan assembled a network of presses and booksellers who published the numerous works turned out by the unknowns and their allies, including the rebel nun Arcangela Tarabotti, the notorious author of the scathing Paternal Tyranny, here you see two of her books, and the then unpublishable Convent Life as Hell. She proposed to do a kind of Dantesque convent as hell, convent as a purgatory, convent as paradise, and she got, as you see, Paradiso Monacale published at the time, but in fact, the first edition of her Convent Life as Hell is less than 10 years old, finally published. Between 1630 and 1640, the unknowns produced about half the books legally published in Venice. Illegal publishers, who relied on false places of publication to cover their tracks, also thrived thanks to patronage from the unknowns. One of Loredan's favorite unlicensed publishers, a man named Francesco Valvazenze, was put on trial in 1648, and his testimony uncovered the underworld of clandestine publishing. Presses running at night and on holidays, operated by shady characters and immigrants whose marginal legal status kept them quiet. Clandestine books seem to have been as readily available to those who wanted them as illegal drugs are today. You just needed to know who to ask. Now, the first editions I have consulted were almost all pocket ones, like this one, quite easy to conceal in case someone is curious about what your reading is. Some of these books, especially those by Loredan and Ferrante Pallavicino, criticized any form of religion. More than any other figure, Pallavicino represented the extremes to which anti-papal rhetoric, religious skepticism, and the freedom of thought could reach during the 17th century, at least in published form. Born in 1615, Pallavicino took vows as a Lateranense canon at the age of 16, before he had the chance to taste, as one of his admirers put it, the carnal delights of liberty and the pleasures of the world. On a pretense, he obtained leave from his monastic superior and fled to Venice, where he took up with a series of prostitutes and began a career as a writer. Without money of his own, he survived from the income from his extremely popular books and by working as Loredan's private secretary. His novelle, histories, and essays were in such demand that by the late 1630s, they were sold at a high markup and were translated into English and French. And in fact, let me just briefly mention these two books on the slide, which I think are a good example of why he might be popular. You can see that this one here is titled La Retorica della Puttana, delle Puttane, The Rhetoric of Whores, which is based upon the Jesuit manual given to the Jesuit students in the colleges, and it includes an older prostitute teaching a younger prostitute the tricks of the trade, all through the rhetoric of Jesuit preaching. And the other one, this is my favorite one, the Celestial Divorce. Jesus Christ goes to God the Father and says, I've got to divorce the Roman Church. She just sleeps with anybody. She's so corrupt. I can't do anything. I got to get rid of her. And God needs to investigate this. So he knows he can't trust St. Peter, so he sends St. Paul down to Rome. And St. Paul roams around Rome and discovers that it's unredeemable. Can't save it at all. So he comes back and tells God that Christ can divorce the Roman Church. And Christ then has a problem. Well, who's he going to marry now? And he discusses marrying Luther or Calvin or the Greeks and decides not to marry anyone. In Italy, I would go on, an eager public awaited each of his new books to see what outrageous things he had to say, especially outrageous things he had to say about the Barberini Pope, Pope Urban VIII, and his nephews, and the Jesuits. This is, of course, the Pope that silenced Galileo. And if you go to Rome, you see the Barberini bees all over the place. Pallavicino's highly personalized satires of high church officials were his undoing. In an act of bravado, Pallavicino dedicated the satirical Bacinata to one of his most ardent enemies, Monsignor Francesco Vitelli, who was the papal nuncio in Venice. In his dedication, he punned on Vitelli's name, pointing out that it meant calf or vitello, which, quote, shows you are descended from cattle and you are assured of a natural sympathy with those animals. And in fact, the Bacinata, I think, as far as I can tell, is a word he made up, probably to confuse the censors, but if anybody has an idea what it might really mean, I'd love to find out. In response, Vitelli demanded that the Venetian authorities place Pallavicino under arrest, which they did. After 6 months in prison, Loredan engineered his friend's release, but Pallavicino now lived a very precarious existence in Venice. He kept busy writing scurrilous books, but in the end, his own ambition lured him away from the safety of the Republic of Venice, something similar to what had happened to Galileo, who wanted to make more money by going back to Florence. A secret agent for the Pope convinced Pallavicino that no less a personage than Cardinal Richelieu in France wanted to hire him as an official historian. Pallavicino took the bait and followed his betrayer right to the gates of Avignon, which was still papal territory at the time, where he was imprisoned, tried for lèse majesté, convinced and executed by decapitation at the age of 28. His capital crime, interestingly, was not heresy, but his refusal to acknowledge the Pope's universal sovereign power, which of course was the very claim that had enraged him and his Venetian friends the most, and a belief of which, of course, he was certainly guilty. Pallavicino's death made him more of a martyr to the cause of free thought than the silencing of his older contemporary Galileo. And the death made his colleagues among the unknowns much more cautious. However, soon after Pallavicino's death, someone, and I think it was probably Loredan himself, staged a complicated disinformation campaign to advance the martyr's cause against the church. At the center of this campaign which included spreading rumors about dangerous books that did not exist. I suppose this is a 17th century version of alternative facts. And at the center of this campaign was a book that did exist called L'Anima di Frante Pallavicino, The Soul of Frante Pallavicino, there on the right. And this book did exist and was the most virulent attack on the church to come from the circle of the unknowns. The conceit of the book is that the soul of the deceased Ferrante Pallavicino returns to earth one evening to carry on a conversation with his with an old friend named Enrico, and sometimes Loredan used the pseudonym Enrico. Pallavicino's soul reports from the afterlife that not a single pope has been saved since Sixtus V. The reform-minded pope, who loathed the Jesuits and limited the size of the College of Cardinals, but who had died in 1590, more than a half century before. That placed the intervening eight popes in hell. Pallavicino argues to his friend, quote, "It is very true and constant that men do not sin with the intention of offending God, but to satisfy their appetites. They are not made less guilty by punishment, which is incompatible with the infinite mercy of God," end of quote. Despite what he saw as this evident truth, the Christian religion, Pallavicino goes on, is a thing of fear. Indeed, as he says, even the fear of a madman. The only solution, therefore, is to recognize that men, and here's an incredible phrase, men have the ability to establish laws over God. Gli uomini abbiano facoltà di componere leggi sopra Dio. Now that's certainly a radical claim. If humans can impose laws on God, then what is God? Does he have any influence, let alone the power over human events? Would there be any reason for there to be a God, except perhaps, as the deists claim, as the prime mover of the universe? This is a radical fulfillment of Sarpi's idea of a secular state. Pallavicino's soul, speaking from beyond in the conceit of the book, has taken the Christian promise of divine salvation and turned it on its head. The whole scheme, not just of church-imposed penalties, but of divine judgment itself, contradicts the Christian claims of God's infinite mercy. As a result, Loredan, if he were the author, and I think he probably was, has voiced in print what Paolo Sarpi only dared express in the privacy of his own notebooks. Morality does not require religion. Morality does not even require God. Human laws, such as those of Venice, can guarantee a peaceful society. Unbelief, then, has become a higher ethical position than belief itself. This, in the end, is the strongest claim of the people who believe in nothing. But also, in the end, as the martyrdom of Vanini and Pallavicino and the attempted assassination of Sarpi reveal, the deepest challenge of the people who believe in nothing were their intolerable thoughts. Those thoughts, born in doubt, were the last rhetorical flourishes of the Renaissance and the necessary first nods towards freedom of thought and universal religious toleration. Thank you. Can't find any Venetian thinker in the late 18th century who's read Voltaire or talked about it.
I think by the 18th century, the intellectual life becomes really quite retrograde, which is sad, because the French Enlightenment thinkers are looking to people like Cremonini and Padua in this period, and Galileo, etc., as a sort of models. But by then, it's gone.
Well, first of all, I want to thank both our guests for this wonderful...
Thank you.
Before starting with the Q&A, because it was really interesting to see how the historical situation was so much more complex, nuanced, contradictory than we would think at a first glance, and also for this very interesting genealogy of free thinkers that was traced back to Venice. So now, if there are questions, we'll accept.
I'd like to read more about the Academy and Sarpi. It is an absolutely fascinating period.
You can read my book.
Okay.
The one that she mentioned, which is the Cultural Wars of the Late Renaissance. There is. Do you read Italian? There is an extensive study of the Incognita in Italian. Now the author's name has slipped my mind for a second. And there's a young woman down at in Washington named Lynn Westwater, who's published quite a bit about them. And she, her book is out. So Lynn Westwater, yeah.
Thank you very much.
While there was a, in the 16th century, while the Venetians and the Ottoman Empire were fighting, where were the Christians of the former Byzantine Empire, and who were they siding with?
Well, what happened is that, of course, the former Byzantine Empire didn't exist anymore, so we had Greeks and Orthodox Greeks. Their identity was perhaps more Christian than Greek at that time, more Orthodox than Greek. I think they would have thought of themselves, first of all, as Orthodox Christians. Being Orthodox Christians, they hated and feared Catholics and Muslims alike. And perhaps they feared more Catholics than Muslims. It is well known that before Byzantine Constantinople was taken by Sultan Mehmed the Conqueror, the last Byzantine emperor desperately tried to enlist Western support and even offered to put an end to the separation of the churches. And when, in fact, the Sultan took Constantinople, a great part of the Greek church was, rather happy that the union with the Catholics had not taken place, and they thought it far better to obey the Sultan than to obey the Pope. So, but anyway, the feelings of the people, of Greek Orthodox people in time of war, depended, I think, mostly upon where they lived. I mean, Greeks who lived under Turkish domination hoped to be freed, delivered from the Turkish oppressions, and they happily wrote to Venice, send us weapons, send us soldiers, send us money, more than anything else, money, and send us a flag with St. Mark, and we are ready. And they believed it, I think, even if there are some people who made very much money posing as envoys of the peoples of Greece to Venice. But anyway, at the same time, Greeks living under Venetian domination, waited for the Turks to free them from Catholic oppression. And they sent people to Constantinople to tell to the Sultan, just come and we are ready to be your subjects, which in fact happened. When the Sultan's troops took Cyprus, the peasants and their priests went to embrace the so-called invaders. And when a Turkish fleet stopped by Crete's beaches and sent some parties to the land during the same war, but Crete was still in Venetian hands. And when the mountaineers saw the Turkish fleet and Turkish soldiers on the beaches, they went down with their priests and crosses to welcome them, only to discover that the Turks were not there to take possession of Crete. They had no heavy guns. They were just passing by. And when the Turks embarked and went away, the Venetian authorities, first of all, calmed down and waited for the mountaineers to get back to their villages, promising that everything would be well. And then they secretly arrested and hanged a dozen of priests. And for the moment, everything was well in Crete. So the Greeks, well, it depended. What is remarkable is that Greek culture, Greek historians, from the time of Greece's independence in the 19th century until our own time, I think, tend to see just one of the two parts of this picture. They insist on how much Greeks hated the Muslim, the Turks, and how much Greeks fought for independence against the Turks. They tend, I mean Greek intellectuals, Greek historians, they tend to read their past is a past of a continuous fight against the Turks, and they tend to obliterate the other part, their own countrymen who sought for Turkish help against Venetian, Italian, Catholic oppression.
Okay. So the next question is really related to what you asked, actually, the Byzantine Empire. I think it will be interesting to think about the Fourth Crusade and in 1204, and which was, you know, sponsored by Venice, and how it weakened the Byzantine Empire, the sacking of Constantinople, etc. So, history books always tell us it was the Ottoman Empire, the Turks, which made the Byzantine Empire collapse. But I think Turks, and I'm Turkish, by the way, Turks are taking too much credit for that. It was really, in my opinion, Venice, which really set the stage for the fall of the Byzantine Empire. I mean, by the time when Turks attacked 1453, the empire was so weak that it was really a piece of cake to capture Constantinople. Would you agree with that?
I think we both completely agree. I would even say that among specialists, it's a fact. If it still hasn't percolated to public opinion at large, it's sad, because it's a fact that the Byzantine Empire was destroyed by Western capitalism. Can I say that? The fact is, here we have an empire with an all-powerful state, centralistic, with even something like an ideology against subjects becoming too rich, an empire whose government affected to protect the poor against rich landowners, for instance, a government which didn't like trade and moreover anything, free trade, an empire with very strict regulations. And on the other side of the Adriatic Sea, you have medieval Italy, which meant to the Byzantine, first and foremost, medieval Venice, but also Genoa, who develop a free capitalism with incredible strength. And the Byzantine Empire simply is not equal to this situation. Venetian merchants come into the empire and they offer new techniques, new services. And the emperor has no commercial network and accepts, is bound to accept the conditions Western merchants offer, which means the trade network in the Byzantine Empire very soon is in the hands of Italian merchants. They make the money. And when they decide to use force against a Byzantine government who will not comply so easily to their demands, they do it with no problems at all, Fourth Crusade, which means that in fact Italian merchants ate the Byzantine Empire alive, and they left just the bones to the Turks to conquer.
I was wondering if the occurrence of free thought that you described had any influence or related to the development and painting and architecture in Venice, or are they different?
It's a very interesting question. I mean, when you think, go to the Met or watch any major museum of Venetian art, this period we don't look at in the 17th century, early 17th century. Once Titian is dead and Tintoretto is gone and the Veronese, things skip to the 18th century. This is actually not a period of a particularly artistic interest. Why? That's a bigger question. What is going on clearly is in music. Venice is becoming, especially after Monteverdi goes there, becoming the musical capital, not only of Italy, but perhaps of Europe. This is where all the action is. And it perhaps has to do with just the interests of the patron, of the upper classes who pay for all of this stuff. They become more and more interested in music and in these kinds of intellectual endeavors. So the degree to which it would have any, I think not. It's almost the inverse relationship.
Other questions?
You told two stories that are fascinating, that are partly contemporaneous. I was wondering if there's any way of connecting the two. Is there any, not necessarily causal relationship, but is there any connection between this relative pragmatism with regard to a Muslim empire and free thinking?
I have an answer, and you give your answer. We have in modern political thought a principle called raison d'état, reason of state. It originates with Giovanni Botero, who is a, can you hear? I'll just try to be loud.
Try this one.
I'll try this one. He's very interested in, so here is a principle that is to govern states in which the immediate moral considerations need to be set aside for the greater good of the survival of the state. When you read Botero, what he's really obsessed with are the Ottomans. That's why you have to have what we would see as a fundamental principle of modern statecraft. Is it begins as an anti-Ottoman phenomenon. In Venice, their relationships with the Ottoman Empire is always deeply ambivalent for very reasons that we just heard, in the sense that they need them as trading partners, even though they're often enemies. Things get pretty bad by the middle of the 17th century when they eventually do lose Crete, piece by piece losing their empire that they get basically after 1204 in the Fourth Crusade. So that's how I would do it. How would you connect us? Sorry.
In fact, I've got no answer. I've got another question. You have shown us a network of individuals, of intellectuals, among them also some noblemen and politicians, high-ranking politicians, who undoubtedly shared a vision, a vision so complex that most most people at that time couldn't probably understand. On the other side, we have the people of Venice, fishermen, rowers, petty merchants, every one of them deeply Christian. What I would like to understand is, what about the patricians? What about the ruling class? You talk about some individuals. Do you think that the habit of tolerance, even if it was an ingrained habit for political reasons, most patricians in Venice probably did defend the tolerance towards the professors in Padua mainly because they didn't want the Pope to interest himself into the inner politics of Venice, which doesn't mean that they shared values of tolerance. Do you think that, in fact, beyond the individuals you mentioned, the habit of protecting free thinking made a progress in the culture of the Venetian nobility at large, which means, of course, that noblemen would be very different in mentality from their own people.
Only some. The Venetian patriciate is divided on this issue. There's a strong faction who want the Jesuits back and who embrace the Counter-Reformation. And there's a strong faction who, as we were talking about, just don't want outside interference. Now, that doesn't make them following Pallavicino all that much. That doesn't make them intolerant of every difference. They don't want, I mean, for this, the French are the same way. They don't want the Pope interfering with their church. The Spanish don't want the Pope interfering with their church. And the French and the Spanish already have guarantees in some ways that the papacy can't do that. Venice is wanting something that other states already have, and the papacy wants to interfere in Venice's affairs. It wants to use Venice as an example. So a lot of people, for political reasons, are there. Pallavicino is a wild outsider. To say that he, how wide his views are accepted is hard to tell, except for the fact, and how do we, I mean, this is the problem historians face. How do we trace what was popular ideas? His books really sold. They're very, you can go to any major library in the Western world, and they're full of books by the Incogniti, and especially by Pallavicino, in English and French and Italian. The biggest single collection I've been able to find is actually in Chicago. But there's probably a big collection here at the New York Public and certainly at the universities. There's a big one at the Folger. So, you know, when the robber barons in the United States were buying up libraries, this is one of the things they got. The libraries were full of this. So that's, we historians try to trace the spread of ideas through publishing records because it's a market, you publish what people will buy, people bought it. Beyond that, it's hard to say. It really is hard to say how far it went.
This is probably a follow-up question. You mentioned the French philosophers of the Enlightenment and how they paid respect, they paid homage to those free thinkers of a previous era in Venice. Why exactly did Venice stop to be the cradle of free thinking and France became that place?
Well, that's, it's one of those $64 questions that I wish I had the answer for. Why do civilizations rise and fall? And this is one that, as an intellectual center, clearly did lose its bearings, I think. The University of Padua is a good example. In the late 16th, early 17th century, this is where all the intellectual action was. You think about it, Vesalius was there. The first botanical gardens. This was in a major intellectual center, and then it just becomes moribund. And I wish I knew the answer. The one area, as I mentioned before, that really keeps thriving is music. And it seems to me people's interests shifted and they weren't willing to get engaged in the larger European set of connections that were essential for keeping up to what's going on, particularly in the new thinking about science.
Just a couple of questions, because so worth.
Yes, since you have discussed the 18th century, it came to my mind that a good example was Mr. Giacomo Casanova. Did he wind up with a stiff prison sentence from which he managed to escape very ingeniously, more because of things he had written or said, or it was things like Swindon?
Well, he messed a little too much with nuns and daughters of patricians as well as widows. I'm thinking more about his question. When you get into the 18th century, the centers of Enlightenment thinking in Italy were Naples and Florence. And it may be there was a kind of complacency in Venice. They already had a republic. They had already been doing just fine for a long time. And I think there's a kind of intellectual complacency there. In Venice is publishing a lot of Enlightenment books, but there's not much evidence that anybody in Venice actually read them, which is an interesting problem.
May I not ask a question, but give an answer to the question asked by the gentleman? You were asking about the difference. Why is Venice fading and everything goes to Paris, let's say, and the Paris becomes the most important place in Europe for culture and the encyclopedists and all the others? Well, I think it's an economical question. The moment when the sea is more important from Spain to the Americas and the Mediterranean is losing its first place, meaning that also Venice is losing its first place and economically is dwindling, the action turns towards another university, which is the Sorbonne, and the university in Paris, where everybody gets together and where the big ideas will start flourishing. Good or bad, revolution, French Revolution or not, but that's where the action is.
No other? Just the last question.
I'd like to know what scholars think today of why Galileo was put under house arrest. Certainly, it could have not been for the fact that he believed in a heliocentric world, because the cardinals and the pontiffs of the time were very educated people, and I'm sure that most of them, if not all of them, believed in a heliocentric world. Isn't it possible that they were opposed to Galileo, not for those beliefs, but for the fact that he said that God created the universe, he imprinted mathematical formulas in the universe, and that the universe will act or be forever, will continue to be in accordance with those laws, which means that the immanence of God becomes irrelevant.
That's right. God would be constrained by those laws, yes.
Exactly.
You're absolutely right that it's not Copernicanism that does him in. There's plenty of people, including many Jesuits, who discuss and embrace these ideas. There are two answers that I can think of. One is Galileo had a loud mouth, and he was decidedly impolitic. He put into the dialogue of the two chief world systems, which is the book that got him into big trouble, into the words that were spoken by the Pope Urban VIII into the mouth of a character called Simplicio, who was the idiot who couldn't quite understand what the Copernican system was. So that's part of it. Had he been a little less vocal, he probably wouldn't have done that. Also, going to Florence was a problem because there he was subject ultimately to the Inquisition. They wouldn't have been in Venice. The other answer is not mine, but it's the answer of Pietro Redondi with a very controversial book, but it's quite interesting book, based upon documents that he found in the archive of the Holy Office, where he found a letter by a man named Grassi, a Jesuit named Grassi, who says that we're going to have to... Galileo is an atomist. He believes that you can divide all matter into a fundamental particle of atomism, which I get from Lucretius. And if that's true, that we cannot possibly sustain the doctrine of transubstantiation if he spreads the ideas about atoms. But that is so dangerous to even talk about it. We should not try him on that, but we should try him on the Copernican reason. That is a book that's got followers and enemies, but it's an intriguing hypothesis, and he does have the letter that says this. The question is that why they did they follow the letter?
Okay, so we thank very much our guests, but I also which was a really enlightening evening, but I also would like to thank all of you for coming, and the artistic planner of the program of La Serenissima for Carnegie Hall, who is here, Mr. Jason Baghdad. Thank you again. Thank you again for having us participate in a wonderful, wonderful program.